I was invited by John Lasseter to come aboard as a director to develop a bunch of ideas for movies. John said to me, well, I would really like it if you would just consider just the world of video games. I thought, well, I like video games. It's neat to be able to use something from my childhood, you know, that kind of evokes nostalgia in me. So, John Lasseter is asking me to develop an animated movie at Disney about video games. There's nothing wrong with any part of that sentence.
I'm a huge video game fan. I grew up with games as a kid. The idea of being able to make a movie about something I love felt really appealing. I've always loved movies like Toy Story, where you go behind the scenes and you kind of discover something you never realized actually happened. And in the case of Toy Story, when you leave the room, the toys come to life. And so this same conceit is sort of true here in Wreck-It Ralph.
We wanted characters that evoked kind of those early days of video games, so we went with kind of a Donkey Kong dynamic for Felix and Ralph.
For the first at least month, I would say, if not longer, came up with a full movie pitch outline with Felix as the protagonist. And we had the Ralph character was this sort of grubby dude named Wendell Grubble.
And he was more kind of like a beast that lived in the trash and threw garbage at Felix.
One day, I was like, why are we talking about this guy so much? This guy should be the lead of our movie. And it was like light bulb moment.
This idea of this 8-bit villain having this existential crisis of what is the meaning of life? I do my job every day and I get no appreciation for it. I've been doing it for 30 years and is this gonna be how it is for the rest of my life? I loved that spiritual kind of break, you know, in this very kind of simple little cartoon character.
We started down that road and redid the entire movie. Here we are.
When we were designing the look of the movie and different worlds in the movie, we narrowed it down to an old school game, an 8-bit game, a more modern shooter game, and then a kart racer.
Typically in an animated film, you create one believable, compelling world, but in this case, we were creating four. So you really are basically creating four movies. That's a lot to embark upon.
Niceland and Fix-It Felix Jr. World started with a little sketch Rich Moore did of a building and a character getting moved off his land.
We wanted it to feel like it was a small town, that it was something from another era.
We added trees with lights in them to make it a little more like Central Park, and the little train, you know, ling, 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 and just the little charming elements of a quaint town that you might be would want to live in, because that's where he's going to end up at the end of the movie. He's going to live there, so you don't want it to be this barren wasteland.
Good job, everyone.
And John Lasseter was, he's a great partner to work with because he would always kind of stress, okay, you know, really, really celebrate what makes 8-bit, you know, so kind of appealing and simple.
Which means simplified repeating patterns, simplified colors. Back then, they didn't have a lot of high resolution. They had to take a very small image and scale it up.
One of the most basic structural things that we did visually was to have a different shape language for each of the different worlds. The obvious choice for the 8-bit world was the square.
It's 8-bit land, so you didn't want to get too fancy. The keywords in that world were simple and clean.
It was a really hard struggle to find that nice place where you believe it's a finished frame in a film, yet it's got a simplicity to it. You know, because we were stripping out so much detail, so much of the shading.
Well, I did not know that.
Probably the biggest challenge in that world was from an animation standpoint, because we're going to animators that are some of the best in the world, and we're saying to them, don't do your best animation.
For us to go back and forget about some of those rules and things that we learned over the many, many years was very challenging.
And really the key was keeping the characters on a grid, so the characters actually never move diagonally in any shot whatsoever.
There was no real kind of banking of the head. There was no real complex movements. We took all that out. I had a blast watching these characters, you know, come to life.
But we thought, well, we're gonna make Ralph the one exception. So he kind of moves more naturalistic, like he's just, I don't care.
Cherry chasing dot muncher isn't even part of this game.
The goal that was given to us was
celebrate the cube. For example, when Ralph is punching down the bricks to make his bed for the night, the dust that's kicked up is also based on cubes that are just bunched together and then are scaled down.
Phil Johnston and I, at one point, thought we had cracked the whole idea of how these characters travel from game to game when Felix discovered a magical vortex in a toilet in his game. After about 3 days, we realized, well, that's really stupid. You know, it has nothing to do with video games or arcade culture at all.
Phil Johnston, the screenwriter, lived in New York City at that time, and Rich Moore had gone back to New York to spend some time writing on the project, and the two happened to be in Grand Central Station.
We're kind of walking through there, just racking our minds, like, what is the device? And Phil just said, what if it's like this? It's Game Central Station, power strip in the arcade, and all the plugs are in it, like these train tunnels, and they get on cars, and they go from game to game.
Welcome to Game Central Station.
The entranceways were kind of modeled after subways and things like that. So you've got the tiled textures along the walls, and we did these kind of fluorescent lights. They've got flicker to it.
We also played up the atmospheric feeling so that it felt like a much larger space, very grand and more realistic.
All of those characters in those scenes are animated differently. Each character has a different way to walk, a different way to look, a different way to actually move. So from an animation standpoint, you couldn't sit there and have one animator just think one way in terms of an animation. They had to actually think about these characters. What era of video games did they come from?
Here was something. Here was Duty.
Hero's Duty, we knew we wanted to be this place where Ralph would be so out of his depth.
His world is simple. We wanted this one to be very complex. We wanted it to be very overwhelming.
A place that would turn him into a blithering idiot amid this swarm of bugs.
When did video games become so violent and scary?
It's the brand new game in the arcade, so it needs to be state of the art. We need to push the envelope.
It should feel kind of the most hyper-realistic of any of the worlds.
Look at that high definition. It's amazing.
Games today, they look like movies. We felt like we can't just emulate that. We have to kind of push it a little bit more.
We wanted the world to feel aggressive. Everything has a sharp point to it that makes you feel like this isn't a world you want to spend a lot of time in.
Everything's made out of triangles. Even the ground is made up of plates of triangles.
We met with John Lasseter, and he looked at us and he said, you've created an amazing world, but I think you can push it much further. And he said, what I really want you to do is go look at the beginning of Saving Private Ryan and look at Aliens and see to what extent you can create the most chaotic 4 minutes of animation that we've seen on the screen before.
When you watch Saving Private Ryan and the camera is shaking and there's explosions going off all around you and things are flying by, you feel like you went through that. And we wanted to create that same feeling with Ralph when he comes out and that door drops, that he's just dropped himself into this world that he's completely in over his head.
Spielberg puts light behind mist, but Ridley always strobes it, so it's blink, 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 blink. So we then started going, all right, every shot, we're gonna start sticking these cans, shooting out mist, and then strobe behind him, flash, flash, flash.
The air is really thick. What we kind of developed was this, what we call black snow. It was kind of like if something was burning and there was ash falling everywhere.
During the battle scenes, it's kind of blowing around very violently and there's a lot of turbulence in it.
So we kept adding and adding and adding and adding until every shot had so much going on.
You don't have a lot of frames in which to kind of read what's going on. The color scheme that we ended up with was that the good guys have orange as their main accent color. So they all have these orange-lit faces, and then the bugs are in this fluorescent acid green, so that you always know who's the good guys, who's the bad guys.
Oh no, there's something coming out of their bottom!
Game over.
What a ripoff.
One of the biggest challenges was, how do we make the arcade feel the most real of all the worlds. When we have a world like Hero Studio and we say we want that animation in that world to be as hyper-realistic as it can be, so we decided to go caricatured.
Morning, kids, come on in. Good to see you, good to see you.
The difference between Hero's Duty and the real world was that in Hero's Duty, the things that were emphasized in the caricature were the more idealized things. Like the guys had very wide shoulders and tiny waists, and Calhoun had ideal measurements. And the people in the real world tended to be more like people that you would see in a real arcade.
I think our design department really captured very well the lighting of an arcade, the look and the feel of the place, and I can almost kind of smell it. It's kind of a conglomeration of places from today mixed with places that I spent a lot of time as a kid that just kind of really evoke that Southern California mission architecture.
What we also did was we made it a kind of darker environment, so it was really all the light for the most part was from the games except for the door you entered. Even if there was a row of games that you couldn't see that was off in the distance and out of camera, we'd flash lights from those games onto the walls and ceilings, so you felt like that whole arcade was lit up and populated.
The story idea specific to Ralph, again, was this idea of, here's a guy who's loud, boorish, ill-tempered. What's the worst place for him? Well, a place where there are very sweet children and all kinds of things that would just be vile to Ralph.
No. This is that candy go-kart game over by the whack-a-mole.
For the longest time, we struggled with creating a world that was more than just the stereotypical Candyland or Hansel and Gretel's witch's house, the gingerbread house, or something like that.
One of our top VizDev artists here, Lorelei Beauvais, came up with the idea of using Gaudi-type design.
Growing up in Spain, I just grew up with the architecture of Antoni Gaudi and other modernists. Just walking when I was little, I saw at all the houses, and I'm like, it looks like candy houses, and it stuck in my mind. It looked like little pieces of cracked candy stuck on the houses.
And I was like, oh my God, that's right. I didn't even think about Gaudi. So we really dug into his architecture.
Mike Gabriel came to me and said, we would like you to build a model of Sugar Rush out of candy. Instantly, the kid in me took over. That was my job to figure out, oh, what exactly is this? So I had to crush wafers and cookies and things to make sort of like gravel.
We looked at those things over and over for the next year, year and a half, but they were really useful. When you're working on this movie, you don't have dessert, because dessert is work, it's hard work.
I ate a little bit of candy the first few days working on the models. After the first day or two of sugar high, I could barely look at it.
The world's set entirely in candy, and that isn't an easy thing to do in the world of CG.
Our brains are so tuned into, you know, how food needs to look and what makes it appealing. We brought three different food photographers in so that we understood really how to make food appealing.
The audience should want to, you know, reach out and eat the things in that environment. The lighting is much softer. There's no dark shadows.
So our technology team spent a lot of time creating what we call the gummy light, which was a way to have light go through something to make it feel realistic and, if you will, yummy.
For Sugar Rush, he wanted it to feel like a real classic Disney animated film. We were referencing a lot of Alice in Wonderland in the classics.
You look at King Candy and his movement and his acting, it all comes from the principles of 2D animation. It really helps set that world apart.
Milk my duds! It's Wreck-It Ralph!
We weren't hand-drawing this movie, but nevertheless, we did need to evoke some of those shapes and that style, that comic timing. For example, when Ralph falls into the taffy pit, there's a very nice splash. It's got a very kind of classic umbrella shape that you would see from, say, Pinocchio or Alice in Wonderland.
Our effects animators were responsible for making that little lake of Diet Cola. Whoa. And also for the end of the film where the top of the mountain where all the Mentos are falling in and everything explodes. There's nothing better than actually doing it yourself. And that's the best reference that we can use.
Look out!
So how'd I do?
Despite how different each of the worlds are, we always let story and emotion drive what makes them unique. And in that way, they're very similar. With Wreck-It Ralph, I tried to stress kind of the uniqueness of each world, but at the same time, perform the balancing act of letting them exist in one movie. I'm really proud of what the artists and the technicians here at Disney have done together. And I think it makes for a beautiful movie.
Hi folks, Chris Hardwick here, and you found the Gamer's Guide to Wreck-It Ralph. I'm about to expunge on you some nerdtastic knowledge by uncovering a handful of the many game references and Easter eggs hidden throughout the film. You probably noticed them already, but I'm gonna take you through. I'm sort of like your gamer's reference cheat code. But, of course, if you want to challenge yourself and find them on your own, that's perfectly fine. You can turn off this intermission in the setup menu. That'll allow you some time to pause and frame advance through the movie. Ready? Fight!
Okay, as you were saying.
Recognize these fellas? Well, that's none other than Pete Pepper from Burger Time and Ryu from Street Fighter. That was kind of a gimme. You guys already knew that one, so come back when you're ready for more. So I was hanging out at the Badanon meeting, because, you know, I'm a bad guy, but that does not make me a bad guy. And I turned to Zombie, because, you know, zombies. I have this thing with zombies. They're awesome. Don't worry about it now. The important thing is, I turn to Zombie and I'm like, what happened to Game Central Station? There's graffiti everywhere. Is someone not have a sponge? Is someone gonna take care of that? And then Zombie turns to me and, you know, he gives me that look that he gives. He's like, ah, graffiti! Shoryuken! Shoryuken! I'm like, all right, take it down a notch. I'm right in front of you, I hear you. But of course, all you Street Fighter fanboys should recognize that. See, now it all makes sense. You still have one of these in the trunk of your DeLorean? Clearly, Q-Bert wrote some bad language on the wall. Does he have spell check? Like, one day, just some letters would be awesome. Check out the rest of the graffiti at your leisure. It is all over Game Central Station. Happy hunting, nerdlings. Look at that high score. I mean, I know it doesn't really look that high compared to today's game standards. It must be from back in the day when a point was actually just worth a point. Well, with that said, if you look a little closer, I mean, there's gotta be some meaning. I mean, these things don't just happen by accident. Let's just say it all started with a mouse, or at least the man behind the mouse, or the birthday of the man behind the mouse, or you get the point. Walt Disney was born on December 5th, 1901, or 12501. But that's not the only Disney reference. If you stick it out to the end of the movie credits, you'll actually get to see the kill screen for the movie with some Leet speak embedded throughout. For those of you not fluent in Leet, here's Walt Disney Animation Studios, Mickey Mouse, and Once Upon a Time. My dad owned a bowling center, and there was an arcade in there, and I used to line up all my quarters on the cabinet of one of my favorite games, Fatal Assault. You know the way the dinosaur used to totally fatally assault the octopus was... You don't remember Fatal Assault? Fatal Assault. Guys, you need to press pause more often. All right, I'm lying. Fatal Assault is a fictional game made up for the movie in Litwack's arcade. But the characters are not fictional. You may recognize these guys as... Tiny the Dinosaur, Lefty the Octopus from Disney's Meet the Robinsons, which, come to think of it, is technically made up too. Speaking of Tiny, you may have also seen him wandering around Game Central Station, along with a few other Disney characters mixed into the crowd of gaming celebrities.
Any gamer will tell you that a bad voice performance
can ruin a perfectly fine game.
Or movie, for that matter. Oh, good. That's why the filmmakers made sure that some of the actual voice talent was used for their gaming characters. Like Ken and Ryu.
You wanna head to Tapper's, Ken? If you're buying, buddy.
M. Bison?
You're not going turbo, are you?
And Sonic the Hedgehog.
Game over.
Enough said, nerds. If you're like me, and if you're watching this, you probably are, then you can't get enough of the game that blew every geek's mind from convenience store to bowling alley in 1987. Wreck-It Ralph features cameo by the following Street Fighter characters. Okay, did you catch that? Too fast? Let's do that one more time. M. Bison, Zangief, Blanca, Chun-Li, Cammy, Ken, Ryu, Dalzim, E-Honda. You're welcome. The only thing not in the lost and found at Tapper's are the countless quarters I spent at the arcade growing up. Back in those days, some games were only a quarter. That's right, if you're looking for some iconic symbols from the arcade archives, check out Tapper's box of lost treasures. Tapper keeps everything in stock, from the Super Mario Brothers mushrooms to... Oh, that's adorable! All you hardcore nerds out there are gonna recognize this one from Metal Gear Solid, right? It's complete with sound effect! And getting technical for a moment, does anyone know what the population of Niceland has in common with the standard graphics resolution of an 8-bit game? They are both 224 by 256, duh! This used to look awesome! This is all we had! You kids are spoiled! There was a time when squares would shoot lines at other squares! We had it rough. Okay, can someone bring us back into high def now? I'm very claustrophobic. Hidden Mickeys officially do not exist, but any Disney geek will tell you that if you look closely at many Disney films or attractions or products, there may coincidentally be three circles worked into the design that may look like the leader of the club that's made for you and me. Check out Ralph's HUD in Hero's Duty. You see the hidden Mickey? All right, if you take any longer, you're gonna get attacked by a cybug. Oh, and you're dead, you missed it. Here it is. Here's a scene from Sugar Rush. Do you see this? Because it's a little tricky. I will neither confirm nor deny whether more exist in the movie. I can't show you everything, especially since hidden Mickeys officially do not exist. But they exist. No celebrity hangout is complete without a character wall of fame, and Tapper's is that place in Game Central Station. Check out some of the frequent guests at this digital watering hole. Huh? There we go, look at that. Oh, you don't recognize this one? Well, if you paid attention to some of the other bonus features of this disc, you would recognize that this is none other than Wreck-It Ralph's director, Rich Moore. I really hope there's a sequel so I can get my picture up there. Please, Rich Moore. I love you. Behold the world's most famous cheat code! Up, up, down, down, left, right, left, right, BA start. That's used by King Candy in the movie. He obviously was not trying that hard to keep whatever was in his vault secret. By the way, I bet most old school gamers probably use that as their passwords for a variety of things, just in case you want to hack into your dad's bank account. Game Central Station is a great place to connect with some old friends, like these guys. I feel a little nostalgic. I need a tissue. Ah! Hubert is, if he's an alien or some unholy genetic laboratory creation, but whatever he is trapped on a pyramid, and for some reason, someone has confined this poor little guy to change colors on all these squares. You could get pounced on by a coiled snake or a weird kind of blobby ball, which Hubert did not like, which you would know because he would burst into a string of swears, which as a kid, I really enjoyed. I love that ball of hair. I just want to hug that guy. What is he? What crime against nature did he commit to be formed the way that he was? And then in a movie, completely out of work. This guy has not had a good life. I think we need to set up a Hubert fund right now.
Welcome to Little Wax Arcade, where we have fun, friends, and Fix It Felix Jr. featuring Wreck-It Ralph. It's all new, fully 8-bit, state-of-the-art, and the hottest arcade game in the world. Test your skills against this totally rad wrecker who loves living up to his Wreck-It name.
Fix It Felix!
Only you can save Niceland.
I can fix it.
And be the hero. Fix It Felix Jr. featuring Wreck-It Ralph. Now at Little Wax Arcade on Route 83, offering two free quarters on your birthday. For 1997, Sugar Rush Speedway. Choose your racer. Get cooking in Bake a Car mode. Let them eat cake. But watch out for Jawbreakers, Sweet Seekers, and the Sugar Crash. Sugar Rush Speedway.
Play the sweet new game only at Litwax Arcade on Route 83, offering four free quarters on your birthday. Proof of birthday required.
Distant world. An invasion is spreading. War is building. And the fight for survival is just beginning. One world. One chance, one duty. Hero's duty. It's the biggest duty of all.
Come on down to Litwax Arcade, where you can play the hottest new game in the world, Hero's Duty. Now at Litwax Arcade on Route 83, offering a double points power card. Only on your birthday. State or federal legal proof of birthday required.
Tired of things going wrong? Don't get down. The Fix It Felix Hammer by Wreck-It Ralph's Fix It Felix Jr. is here for you.
I can fix it.
Rundown house?
I can fix it.
Tummy trouble?
I can fix it.
The election is coming. We can fix it.
President Vanellope von Schweetz.
Act now and we'll throw in a mini Fix It Felix Jr.
I can fix it.
And see Fix It Felix Jr. in Disney's Wreck-It Ralph. November 2nd.
Hi, I'm Rich Moore, the director of Wreck-It Ralph, and I'm really happy to share with you now some deleted scenes from the movie. If you watch with the commentary track turned on, you'll hear part of our thought process as to why we decided to change or ultimately cut these scenes. I hope you enjoy them.
Shut up! I'm singing here! There's a world
that
won't treat
you. It sounds like death!
Huh?
Ralph!
What was that?
Oh! How you doing, brother?
What do you want, Felix?
Well, I had a few minutes, and I wanted to stop by and check up on you. I'm flying another sortie with General Lockload at 1300 hours. Funny thing, he seems to have taken a shine to me. He even made me his wingman. Isn't that super?
Oh, and you came here to tell me that. Gee, thanks.
You're welcome. Anyway, I'm trying to persuade the General to let you go.
Yeah, how?
I think I can convince him to release you under my supervision. I'd be like your parole officer.
Oh, great. Yeah, maybe you could toss me up your belt or tie so I could hang myself.
Ralph, there's something else. Remember Sergeant Calhoun?
How could I forget her?
Well, she gives me the honey glow in my cheeks.
Gives you the what?
I just think she's comely as all get out, don't you?
No, I think she's terrible.
Ralph, I have to be honest. I'm conflicted. I know we have to get back home. But I really like Sergeant Calhoun. No, we have an obligation to the Nicelanders back home. Oh, but she is so neat. No, my name is on that game, just like my father's name was on his. I'll get you out of this jail, and we'll skedaddle home. Decision made. Thank you, Ralph. You always know the right thing to say. I gotta go. Hang in there, brother.
Thanks for coming by, Felix. Really made my day. In case you can't tell, that was sarcasm!
Keep moving, prisoner.
With pleasure, Your Majesty.
Welcome home, Dunderson.
Ooh, my favorite cell. I call top bunks.
Hey! Parachute pants! Yeah. What'd they nail you for, huh? Being too ugly? Nice one! Hey, hit me on the top shelf.
Good thing my feelings are unhurtable.
Whoa, dude, you're hurting. That bumps me out hard, man. Where's the pain coming from, Cochise?
I thought I'd get here and it'd be different, but it's not. Locke, Lode, and Calhoun are just as stupid as the idiots back home.
They don't appreciate you.
They don't appreciate me, amen. And it's like, I'm a good guy, obviously, but no matter where I go, no matter how much better I am than everyone, these imbeciles treat me like I'm bad. I just want to go someplace where I will finally fit in.
Dude, why didn't you say so?
First chance I get, I'm going over the hill for a place made for dudes like us. Here, check this out. Extreme easy living too.
Come on, what makes you think that game would be any better?
Because there's no good guys or bad guys. Just sand, sun, chicks, sharks, beer, volleyball, surfing, tacos, and a hot tub waiting there with your name on it. It's all good, man.
All good?
It is all good, man.
I gotta say, man, looks pretty perfect.
Word! They'll love you there! What with your big fat head and your body odor. And yo, peep this, Cochise. Cheat code. All access, all levels, all the time. All you gotta do is get a ship into deep space, then type the code into the computer. It'll hyperdrive you out of this game to extreme easy living too. Here, give me your hand. R2 triangle square O2 LRX. And here's a little something so you don't forget who did you a solid. Your bud, Bobby Dunderson.
Hang on, Dunderson. Why are you doing this for me?
Because you're my bro, my amigo. You're my bro-migo. I just made up that word right there. And also, because you're going to use those giant anvil hands to bust us on out of here, huh?
Bust us out? I don't know, man. I'm already in a lot of trouble around here. Huh?
I like you, Fix It. For long, we'll be renaming this game Felix's Call. Ain't that right, Calhoun?
That was nice of you to say that.
General, you slay me.
Now what?
Every bro may go for himself.
Hey, Dunderson.
See you on the other side, dude.
Hey! Oh, crud.
Okay, the first part we need is the engine, and to get it, we have to solve the candy corn maze. The first time I tried it, I was lost in it forever.
I heard that the best way to solve a maze is to keep making left-hand turns. My good friend Pac-Man told me that.
Nice name-dropping, Felix. What does Pac-Man know about mazes anyway?
Ah! Howdy, players! Have some candy corn. Welcome to the amazing maze maze.
That's hilarious.
What are you doing here?
Well, usually I don't preside over these challenges, but I wanted to make sure that you got a fair shake. So I'm adding a few wrinkles to the maze that will make it extra fun. first, black licorice crow!
Oh! Shoot! Come on!
They're here to follow your every move, and their incessant cawing has been known to drive men insane. Woo-hoo! How fun is that? Oh, and be careful, they're carrying boom corn.
You mean popcorn?
No! Boom corn. Is that right? It's one false move! Boom!
We go now, please?
No. There's still more fun. I'm releasing a magical unicandy corn into the maze.
He's darling. Hey there, buddy.
Ben didn't give me any advice for a rabid unicorn.
Now, how's that for fun? I almost forgot. You only have 30 seconds to get your engine. And go! Wait, what are you doing? No.
Oh, that was so cool!
It's right there! Hooray! The engine is mine!
We're done, Songbird.
Penelope, I don't mean to be presumptuous, but where are we gonna sleep?
You chums can stay over at my place. It'll be like a slumber party.
Oh, just point me toward the closest pile of bricks, kid, please.
Ralph, she's our host. Don't be rude.
Welcome to my home, the abandoned nougat mines of Mount Fudgesuvius.
How lovely.
Doesn't look like much of a home to me.
It's better than your home on planet Body Odor.
Actually, we're from Fix-It Felix Jr. It's named after me. I fix things, and everybody loves me.
What about you, Chuckles?
I used to wreck things, and everyone hated me. Ow, Mother Hubbard!
Well, you're from a game where you get to wreck stuff? Awesome.
Yeah, well, it's not as good as it sounds.
Oh, wait, you gotta see this. Gentlemen, my spittin' hole.
Ugh, how unsanitary. No self-respecting person would ever...
Felix, you gotta try this. Man, I wish I had more lube in my mouth. I gob all over this place.
Here we are, the center of Mount Fudgesuvius. My digs.
Ooh, it's toasty on the tootsie.
Oh yeah, that's because we're over the molten nougat core.
Oh, those are inviting signs.
I know, right? And they came with the place. Make yourselves comfortable. I usually sleep here. I bundle these wrappers up and cover myself up like a little homeless lady. Yeah, it's fun.
This is no way for a child to sleep. I can fix it.
When I win the derby, I'm gonna treat Taffeta just like she treats me. No, worse, yeah. Like if I saw her in the street dying, I'd just sit there and watch and laugh my head off.
You could step on her hands too, I bet.
Ooh, yeah, I'll break her hands. That's good.
Exactly, so she couldn't crawl.
And then I'd watch her die. That would be so great.
It sure would.
Ha! That doesn't sound very nice at all. I bet if you two sat down and hashed it out, you could still be friends.
Oh, come on, Felix. You have no idea what it's like to be weird or ugly or revolting like me or this rotten little kid here.
Yeah, everybody automatically likes you because you're the good guy.
Exactly. Me and this little degenerate, we got serious burdens on our shoulders, man. Right, kid?
Right.
Well, it couldn't hurt to be friendly.
Like this?
Oh! Ah! Ah! Hey, quiet! A child is trying to sleep up here.
Ugh. Oh, sorry. Good night, Ralph.
Good night, Felix.
Whoa, where'd that come from?
Mother Hubbard. Extreme easy living too. It's real. And I've already killed someone. Oh, I'm sorry. I'm sorry.
It's all good.
It's all good.
Good, good, good. Good, 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 good. Good, 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 good.
Okay, pretty cool. Thanks. I think.
Good, good. Like it, like it, like it.
Like it.
I don't understand.
Welcome to paradise, Bromigo.
Thunderson.
They said I was crazy, that this whole place was a fairy tale. Well, who's living happily ever after now? And you will too, man. You just gotta master the language. Don't worry, it's only three words.
Good.
Like it.
Good.
And that's about it.
Wow, you were right all along, man.
Yeah, if anything, I undersold it.
Check it out. Yeah, the beach goes on forever. Weather is always perfect. No such thing as troubles. And the living is extremely easy.
Good, because I got a lot of troubles to forget, man.
You gotta start cashing in on some of that popularity, bro, amigo.
All you gotta do is want it.
Stop me when you see something you like.
Oh, sweet advisor.
Pat this man.
Wow.
Man, you could buy yourself a rooftop party with all that light.
That sounds good.
It's all good.
Party, Bromigo.
Yeah,
but everyone does the same step over and over again.
Hey, everybody, let me teach you a new dance, the wrecking ball. First, you gotta shake your hips like this, and then boom!
Like it, like it.
Good, good, good. Like it, good, like it, like it, like it, like it. Good, good, good. Ooh, good, 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 good. Like it, like it, like it, good, good, like it. Like it, good, 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 good.
Where is it?
Good.
Hey, Bromigo, where are you going?
I'm leaving. I gotta go back to the arcade.
Back to the arcade? And leave paradise? Why? It's all good.
No, it's not all good. But I've still got a chance to fix it. Here, you take these. I'll see you later.
Let's keep this party going!